7 or 8 times a day bowel movements, and I had diarrhea frequently and strong pain once a day. So my bowel movement is quite normal. I have no more pain. Well, I feel very happy and quite normal. It was it looks like a miracle almost.
We'll break down exactly how she did it, how she turned around her condition, her diagnosis of IBS, and did a complete 180, all the details and all the science behind it, starting right now. In case the resemblance isn't clear enough, this is my beautiful mom. She struggled with gastrointestinal problems for years. It was really debilitating. 7, 8 bowel movements a day, pain, discomfort. Her quality of life was completely shot.
I felt confined to my house. I didn't dare to go very far away. It was difficult to go anyway, even to the work. And then I had to retire because of that. And I felt a little depressed and unhappy, of course, a little or a lot.
She saw doctors, she saw a gastroenterologist with a great reputation, and he diagnosed her with irritable bowel, IBS, and gave her a list of foods to avoid. Basically what's called a low FODMAP diet.
And they told me to that it had no cure, and told me to avoid a lot of vegetables, fruits and legumes, and that was all.
That was it. This is what you have, and this is what you don't eat now, for the rest of your life. She eliminated most fruits and vegetables. Her diet was mostly white potatoes, white bread, white rice, white pasta, and animal foods. Chicken, fish, eggs, that was the gist. Maybe one or two vegetables here and there, and there were two fruits she could handle, bananas and apples. Most fruits and vegetables were off the table, whole grains and legumes, off limits. She wasn't alone, of course. Unfortunately, we see this pattern more and more, people reporting that they go to this length to try to manage their gastrointestinal problems. But obviously this was a concern for all of us. Of course, she had to avoid foods that triggered the crises, but we worried about the long-term consequences of eating like this. And sure enough, her cholesterol shot up, her blood glucose and blood pressure were all high. We knew how to fix that, in theory. Eating more vegetables, more fiber, and less refined foods, and less saturated fat would bring all those values back to normal. But she couldn't tolerate any of it. We felt like our hands were tied. So at this point, I moved back to Europe to try to help figure this out. We saw more specialists, but the verdict was always the same. You have IBS, and these are the foods you avoid now. I knew we had to learn more. Obviously, there was an underlying issue that wasn't being addressed. So I went through endless material, peer-reviewed studies, books, seminars by researchers and specialists. It was a little overwhelming at first. We had a lot of questions and honestly, not that many answers. But eventually patterns started to emerge. All the experts talked about reintroduction, how elimination diets are temporary. This was the opposite of the message we got from the clinicians who saw my mother, but it aligned with the science. In all likelihood, she had dysbiosis, an imbalance of the microbes in her gut. That would explain her difficulty digesting foods that are fine for everybody else. We know that dietary changes affect the composition of the microbes in our gut very quickly, within days. We also know that it's possible to reintroduce fiber-rich foods without triggering IBS symptoms. One key benefit of fiber is it feeds the microbes in our gut. And those little bugs return the favor by producing short-chain fatty acids, which are very beneficial for our intestinal epithelial cells. So the hope was that by slowly putting back those fiber-rich foods, the short-chain fatty acids produced by the microbiome would help heal her gut. So we started experimenting very slowly and gradually. First, white starches and grains, then whole grains, then legumes, and finally, the greens and other vegetables. This sequence followed the advice of some experts according to ease of digestion of each food. In the beginning, it was really slow progress. She had flare-ups now and then. We would just stop and take a step back and give it a few days and then try again. But after a couple of months of this process, we started seeing some results. Foods that she could not handle before started being okay. It was a light at the end of the tunnel. It was the first indication that we were on the right track. After about 4 months of this, when we got through phase 3, everything changed. Suddenly, she could handle everything. No symptoms. She was just fine. For the first time in years, she felt completely normal. It's now been several months and she's been completely fine.
You know, I eat everything. It's not restricted. I forgot my lists. I even try to eat quite varied food. All kinds of vegetables, all kinds of legumes, all kinds of fruit. When I see something different, I buy and I eat. My bowel movement is quite normal. I have no more pain. Well, I feel very happy and quite normal.
In all likelihood, her microbiome normalized. It was like a muscle that was kind of atrophied and it just needed to be strengthened again. The fiber we reintroduced was the workout that the muscle desperately needed. And the flare-ups were the sore pains when you work out too much and you're hurting the next day. You get the idea. Not surprisingly, now that she's on a very healthy diet again, her cholesterol came down to normal levels, her blood glucose normalized, her blood pressure is looking better. Not surprising, that's all expected. The take-home message here is that we have to be wary of simplistic answers. If food X causes problems, just avoid it. That logic seems like common sense, but it doesn't address the root of the issue, and it may create more problems in the long run. It's a band-aid. My mother's experience illustrates that it's possible to feel great while eating the very foods that used to be a problem. That's reversal. Now, of course, your case might be different. It might take you longer, it might take you medication, you may have other conditions associated, or it may be easier and faster for you. My mother's story is just that. It's an anecdote, and I've cautioned people against leaning too much on anecdotes before, and I want to do it again here. The science showed management of symptoms with reintroduction of fiber-rich foods. All we did was follow the lead of those studies, and sure enough, they worked as advertised. So for you watching, you should mainly look at the scientific evidence, less so the anecdote, and the data should mainly inform your decision-making. And speaking of decision-making, I highly recommend if you're struggling with gastrointestinal issues of this kind, that you see professional help, if you haven't yet. I'm not a professional gastroenterologist, and the internet is packed with unqualified advice, unfortunately. It's really important to get a proper differential diagnosis and to rule out other issues. Get a second opinion, get a third opinion if you need to. In our case, the first doctors we saw didn't have a great solution. The answer was not to give up and go do something random and unscientific. The solution was more expertise, more knowledge, more science. That's where the answers eventually came from. Now, it's not easy. I get that. I just went through the process myself. It took me a lot of time and effort to find the answers. And I do this for a living. Science and medicine are my job. So I can only imagine how hard it is for everybody else out there. And that's why I'm making these videos. If this saves you some time and some suffering that my mother had to go through, then this video has done its job. If you thought that video was useful, consider sharing with others who might be interested and hit that like button and subscribe for more Nutrition Made Simple. Also, feel free to link up with me on my Facebook page and on Twitter for more in-depth nutrition science. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.